instructor series of the operating system. I am your instructor Varshata. Let's start our lecture series. Today we are starting the new unit, that is unit number 7, IO management and their scheduling. So let's start. So at the end of this video, you will be able to learn about the IO devices and organization of the IO devices. Okay, so let's start with the IO devices. Which are the different types of the IO devices? Okay, so there are different types. First type is a human readable device. Human readable, that means what? The device that is capable of interacting with the human, that is known as the human readable devices. It is suitable for the communicating with the computer user. Okay, so examples includes, that is a printer, terminals, and later consisting of the video displays and keyboards and perhaps other devices such as a mouse. These all are the devices that is known as the human readable devices. Because using these devices, human can interact with the computer system. Okay, so these all are known as the human readable devices. Now next is the machine readable devices. Now what is the meaning of the machine readable devices? It is the suitable for communicating with the electronic equipment. For example, disk driver is there, USB keys is there, sensors, controllers. All these devices are known as the machine readable devices. Okay, so it interact with the machine directly. So that's why it is known as the machine readable devices. Now next is the communication devices. It is suitable for communicating with the remote devices. That devices is known as the communication devices. Example includes digital driver, digital line drivers, modems. These all are the known as the communication devices. Okay, so using modem you can communicate with the internet. Okay, so the remote communications provided by this type of devices, that is known as the communication devices. Now next we will see the organizations of the IO functions. Okay, so in the organization of the IO functions, first we know what is the programmed IO. Okay, so what is the programmed IO? Programmed IO, that means what? The processor issues an IO command. IO, that means input output command. Okay, so processor issues IO commands on behalf of the process to an IO module. Okay, so the process then busy waits for the operations to be completed before proceeding. So this is known as the programmed IO. So here it is showing the working of the program IO. What programmed IO do? Okay, so programmed IO, that means what? The processor issues the IO command on behalf of the process and process wait until and unless this operations will complete. Okay, now next is a DMA. What is DMA? This is the most ambitious topic. Direct memory access. A DMA module controls the exchange of the data between main memory and the IO module. IO module, that is with the secondary storage, etc. Everything that is comes in under the IO module, that is input and output. From where we can get input and from we can store the output. Okay, so a DMA module controls the exchange of the data between main memory and the IO module. The processor sends a request for the transfers of the block of the data to the DMA module and is interrupted only after the entire block has been transferred. Okay, so here the processor sends the request for transfers of the block of the data to the direct memory access module and it is interrupted only when this transfer is complete. Now next we see the interrupt driven IO. What is the interrupt driven IO? Interrupt driven IO, that means what? The processor issues an IO command on behalf of the process. Then there are two possibilities. Which are those two possibilities? If the IO instructions from the process is a non-blocking, then processor continues to execute instructions from the process that issues the IO command. Okay, so if the IO instructions from the process is a non-blocking, okay, non-blocking, that means we cannot block it, then the process continues to execute instructions from the process that issues the IO command. That means what? We cannot preempt that process. So that is the non-blocking. For example, you are printing something, that is a non-blocking. Okay, if the IO instruction is a blocking, okay, we can preempt the process, okay, so that we can preempt the resources. So that is what? The blocking. If the IO instruction is a blocking, then the next instruction that the processor executes is from the operating system, which will put the current process in the block state and schedules the another process. Okay, so if it is a blocking, that means another process will be selected for the execution. Now, this table indicates the relationship among the three techniques. It is the most computer system, the DMA is the dominated form of the transfer that must be supported by the operating system. Okay, so all of them, the DMA is the most popular. So here you can see the IO memory transfer through the processor. Then if there is no interrupt, then programmed IO will be used, and using the interrupt, interrupt driven IO will be used. Okay, and using the direct input output to memory transfer, we just use the direct memory access, that is DM. Now let's see the direct memory access. The DMA unit is capable of mimicking the processor, and instead of taking over the control of the system bus, just like a processor, it needs to do this transfer data to and from the memory over the system bus. Okay, so this is the functionality of the direct memory access. What direct memory access can do? It has the capability of mimicking the processor. Whatever the work done by the processor, that should be done by the DMA. So it is the capable of mimicking the processors, and instead of taking the over control of the system bus, just like a processor, it needs to do this transfer data to and from the memory. Okay. Now here the DMA technique works using this following steps. Let's see. When the processor wish to read or write a block of the data, it issues a command to the DMA module by sending to DMA module the following instruction. Some of the instructions will be sent to the DMA module. Now, which instructions will be sent to the DMA module? Let's see first. Okay, so the first information is whether the data has to be read from the memory or the data has to be written to the memory. Okay, whether data is read from the memory or whether the data is read to the memory. So it passes this information via read and write control. Okay, so it passes this information via read and write control lines, and that is between the processor and DMA controller. It is called the control logic unit. Okay, so this is the one of the part of the direct memory access that we will see in the figure. Second information is what? The processor also provides the starting address. Okay, now the starting address is for what? Starting address, that means the base address. Still now we have seen so many examples about the base address, limit address. So all of you are aware about this. Okay, so starting address of the for the data block in the memory, from where the data block in the memory has to be read or where the data block has to be written in the memory. Where we have to write the data block in the memory. Okay, so that is defined by the starting address, and DMA control stores this address in the address that is known as the address register. Okay, and it is also called the starting address register. Okay, now third is what? The processor also sends the word count. Now what is this word count? How many words are to be read or written? Okay, so whenever the data is going to be transferred, how many bytes will going to be written, and when the data when we have to read the data from the disk storage, how many bytes we are able to read? So that is known as the word count. Okay, so it stores the informations in the data count or the word count register. Now next is what? The most important is the address of the IO devices that wants to read or write the data. This information is stored in the data register. Now we require the IO devices to read and write the data. So this information is stored in the data register. Now let's see everything that is defined in the figure. This is the typical DMA block diagram. Okay, so here you can see the control logic, at starting address, data register, and word count is there. Okay, so word count, data register, and starting address have these address lines and data lines, as we have seen in the whatever the information that is defined in the DMA. Now control logic, that defines the read, DMA request, DMA acknowledgement, interrupt, and write. So all these informations that is defined in the DMA block diagram. Now the processor then continues with the other work. Okay, when this access when the control is over to the DMA, the processor will continues with the other work. It has delegated this IO operations to the DMA module. So it delegated this IO operations to the DMA module. DMA module transfers the entire block of the data one word at a time and directly or from the memory without going through the processor. Okay, no, now there is a no role of the processor once the processor hand over everything to the DMA module. When the transfer is complete, DMA module sends an interrupt signal to the processor. Okay, so you can see here in this figure we have the interrupt. Okay, so using this interrupt, it will send the interrupt signal to the processor. When the transfer is complete, the DMA module sends an interrupt signal to the processor. Thus the processor is involved only at the beginning and end of the time. Rest of the time, the DMA module will handle everything to transfer the data or to read the data. Got it? Now here, let's see the operations of the DMA. Okay, so first of all, here the first step is what? The CPU programs the DMA controller. Here you can see the CPU is there. Then we have the DMA controller. When we are accessing the DMA module, we have the DMA controller which will control everything. Here the address count and control is that the information that is stored in the address register, data register, that every information that we have here in the DMA controller. Okay, then this controller will have the control to the data, and then there is a main memory in through which we are going to read or we are going to write the data in the main memory. Okay, so first step is what? First is the CPU programs the DMA control. When we are accessing the DMA module, what will happen? So first step is what? The CPU programs the DMA controller. Okay, so CPU gives the access to the DMA controller. Now what will happen? Here you can see the start point was first the CPU programs the DMA controller by setting the register so it knows what to transfer and where. Okay, so what to transfer and where to be transferred. It also issues a command to the disk controller telling it to read the data from the disk into its internal buffer and verify the checksum. So when valid data are there in the disk controller buffer, DMA can begin. So at the same time, CPU sends the this command signals to the disk controller, and if valid data is there, then DMA can transfer the data, and if valid data is not there, then DMA cannot work. Now second step is what? The DMA requests the transfer to the memory. So in second step, the DMA control initiates the transfer by issuing the read request over the bus to the disk controller. Now this read request looks like any other read request, and the disk controller does not know whether it came from the CPU or whether it came from the DMA controller. Now next is a data transfer. So in third step, data transfer will be done. So the write to the memory is another standard bus cycle that is done in the third step. Okay, now next is what? The fourth, acknowledgement. That means this acknowledgement will be given by the disk controller to the DMA controller, so that means what? The day or the data transfer is complete. So when the write is complete, the disk controller sends an acknowledgement signal to the DMA controller and also over the bus. Okay, here you can see this orange line is showing the bus. So on this bus, each and every signals will be transferred. The DMA controls then increment the memory address to use and decrements the byte count. Okay, so if the byte count is still greater than the zero, then step 2 to 4 are repeated until it reaches to the zero. Okay, so here DMA controller, every time what it will do, it will increment the memory address because data is storing in the memory. So that's why we have to increment the memory address. And we are completing the reading of the data, so we have to decrement the byte count. So suppose for 50 byte is there, if 1 byte is written, it should be decrement to the 49. And same way in the memory address, it should be increased. Okay, so those are the steps that will be performed when we will see the direct memory access. Okay, so these are also known as the operations of the DMA. Okay, and when acknowledgement will be received by the DMA controller, it will send one interrupt to the CPU that data transfer is over. Okay. So in this video, we have learned about the I/O devices and organizations of the I/O functions. We have seen the three different types of the I/O devices. Then we have seen the organization of the I/O function, in which one most important topic that we have covered, that is DMA, direct memory access. Okay, what is it and what are the steps involved in the DMA? So this is all about this lecture. Remaining interesting topic we will cover in the next lecture. Thank you for watching. Thank you.